Thank you. Good evening. Good to see everyone back out this evening. Brother Mike Berry, would you lead us in prayer, please? Yes. Amen. If you would stand and get your All-American Church hymnal, let's turn to page number 32, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather to her on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll just talk of all His wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Roll is called up yonder when the roll is called up yonder when the roll is called up yonder.
Good to be here. If you're visiting first time, I'd like you to raise your hand and we'll give you a card. Let you fill it out, drop in the plate. Anybody first time tonight? All right, good to have everybody here. I'm missing somebody. Over here. All right, good to have you with us. Where are you from? Cupful? All right, good. Amen. Good to have you. Go right by there, through there to get to Nashville. Amen. This newlywed couple came back to see us again tonight. Amen. Down here on the front. Glad to have them. All right. Well, Lord willing, meet Wednesday night at 7 o'clock for prayer meeting. Is this something that's been found? All right. We've got some readers up here that have been found. And this 24-karat gold bracelet, nobody's claimed it yet. So it's up here. All right. God bless you.
I'd have to get that now. I'd like to invite the choir up. We'll be singing out of the All-American Church Hymnal, page number 194, Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us. All that will come sing. Thank you. you would stand again, get your All-American Church hymnal. Let's turn to page number 58, When I See the Blood.
Christ our Redeemer died on the cross, died for the sinner, paid all his due. All who receive him need never fear. Yes, he will pass over you. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Chiefest of sinners, Jesus can save, as he has promised, so will he do. Oh, sinner, hear him, trust in his word, then he will pass over you. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you.
Judgment is coming, all will be there, who have rejected, who have refused. Oh, sinner, hasten, let Jesus in, then God will pass over you. When I see the blood, you'd be seated as the choir comes down.
Let's have the ushers come here tonight and take up the evening offering. Brother Mike Berry, would you lead us in prayer, please? music. Brother Keith Tickell is going to be singing for us tonight.
Wonderful singing about the love of God. Absolutely. And you know, sometimes it wasn't until I really came to know that love in a deep way that I began to and understand who he was and what he did for me that I truly began to understand what loving him was all about. His name is wonderful. My Jesus, I love thee, I love thee. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord. He's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages, Almighty God is He. Bow down before him, love and adore him. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord. My Jesus, I love thee, I know thou art mine. For thee all the pleasures of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. I love thee, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee and dwell in thy sight. I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, 'tis now. I will love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath. And say when the death dew lies cold on my brow, 'tis now.
Beautiful, brother. Amen. Beautiful. Do you know who invented music? And then you know who perverted it? Amen. Turn to the book of Luke chapter 19 with me tonight, please. Luke chapter 19 and verse number 14. Turn to Matthew chapter 4, verse 24. Verse 23 says, "And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with divers diseases and torments, and those which were possessed with devils, and those which were lunatic, and those that had palsy, and he healed them. And there followed him a great multitudes of people from Galilee and from Decapolis and from Jerusalem and from Judea and from beyond Jordan." Father, bless this book now. In your name I pray. Amen. You can be seated. I want to ask you a question tonight, folks. Why do men reject the Lord Jesus Christ? Think about that for a moment. I can understand them rejecting me. All you have to pick long and you'll find all kinds of problems. But why do men reject the Lord Jesus Christ? Why do they do it? You think about that. In Matthew chapter 4, do they reject him because he healed the sick? He heals the sick, no question about it. He still does. Don't let anybody kid you that God heals. He heals. When I pray for someone to be healed, I pray fully believing that the Almighty can heal, that he can heal. And I've seen him do it before. I've seen him heal holes in heart. I've seen him raise people up from the deathbed. I've seen him heal cancer. I've seen him heal heart problems. I've seen God heal. Amen. I've seen it done time and again. In Mark chapter number 5, Mark chapter 5 and verse number 1, why do they reject him? Why do men reject Christ? Mark chapter 5 and verse number 1. "And they came over to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gadarenes." And then what you read here, you're fully aware of it. In verse number 7, "He cried with a loud voice and said, 'What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God?'" Now, it's amazing confession coming from a devil, don't you think? They know who he is. Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? The spirit world knows the spirit world. It's us that are ignorant. In verse number 7, "What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God?" Did that really happen? Did this thing really say that? Because it called him the Son of God. Of course it did. I believe the Bible. "I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. For he said unto him, 'Come out of the man, thou unclean spirit.' And he asked him, 'What is thy name?' And he answered, saying, 'My name is Legion, for we are many,'" many speaking as one. This is another indication of the spirit world. It goes on further down and says, 2,000 had come out of the man. My goodness, he had authority over the spirit world. Do men reject him for that reason? He still does, folks. I think an awful lot of problems in the church could be settled by a good dose of driving demons out. Amen. I really do. Believe me. In the book of Matthew chapter number 14, Matthew chapter number 14 and verse number 16. But Jesus said unto them, "They need not depart. Give ye them to eat." Give them food. Give them something to eat. And of course they did. They said, we don't have money to buy food. But he took what they had. And in verse 19, he commanded the multitude to sit down, took 5 loaves and 2 fishes, and fed thousands with it. Many as much, if the Lord is in it. Amen. Amen. Now, if you've studied much about life, if you've done much reading at all, you understand how well off, how blessed we have been. Amen. I doubt if there's anybody in this house tonight that'll go home to an empty cupboard. I suppose all of you will have somewhere to go to and you'll have something to eat when you get there. But it's not like that all over the world. So why? When you find places where they're hungry, you find places of famine, you find places where they're fighting over food, you find places they're starving to death. Why? Have you ever bothered to really read why? To look into it? Have you ever noticed how that a country that exalts the Lord Jesus Christ lifts him up to his place where he ought to be? In one fashion or another, they're going to have something to eat. There was a thing that came through Ireland called a potato famine. That's why we've got so many Irish in the country. That's all fine. Love Irish. No problem with that. But they had a potato famine. And they left their country finding somewhere to eat. And then, of course, they came into America. And by coming in here, they had somewhere to eat. But that's not the norm. You see, if you go to Ireland today, there's plenty to eat. I've been there. They've got all kinds of food in Ireland. As a matter of fact, when you find most Christian countries, unless there is some specific reason, which is transitory, it'll pass, they've got plenty to eat. God's blessed you. He feeds you. And that's a good reason to check into the religion of the people who have rejected him and deny him. Folks, I know tonight it's hard for us to realize how bad it is. I spent 15 months in Okinawa, and it's just a word to a lot of people, but I was there. And I know what that, and let me tell you something too. I was there about 20 years after World War II. I was there in 64. 45, the war ended. So I was there about 20 years later. And that time, 20 years after World War II, Okinawa was a hard place to live in. Hard place to live. Who's their God? Shintoism. They worship their ancestors. They have shrines all over the place. Is it still like that, preacher? Oh, yes. Yes, it is. And so he gave them food. He fed them. So do men reject Christ because of his humanitarianism? The Christian world has given much. It helps. It's our faith to, when we see someone suffer, to help them, to do something, to show the love of Christ to people. We do that. A lot of times by showing the love of Christ, the doors open where you can show them Christ and you can preach the truth to them and tell them about the Lord. Amen. Amen. In the book of Luke, chapter number 7 and verse number 47, do they reject Christ because he forgives sin? Luke chapter 7, verse 47. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins which are many are forgiven, for she loved much, but to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. Have your sins been forgiven? Mine have been forgiven. Thank God for the forgiveness of sins. Do you understand what religion will do for you, though? It'll heap a load on your back. There are people that crawl, folks, on their hands and knees, and climb hills and climb steps just to do some kind of an act of penance and think that by doing that, that they can earn repentance. They can earn forgiveness from God. You don't earn forgiveness. So how are you forgiven, preacher? You look to the forgiver. That's what you do. You call upon him. You seek him and ask him to forgive you. The Bible said he is faithful and just to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven. And when I say blessed, I mean happy, joyful, rejoices because his sins are forgiven. Can you imagine coming to the house of God and singing and worshiping the Lord with a load of baggage on you that you can't get off? and your soul eaten up with guilt, and you know that one day that you'll have to give an account for all those sins, the Bible says plainly that we must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. And all of us, every one of us will. But it won't be for sins. It'll be for works. It'll be for what you've done to serve the Savior. Amen. So he does forgive sins. I'll tell you right now, there's a lot of people tonight that wish their sins were forgiven. Oh, how they wish they were forgiven. They'd pay large sums of money. There are millionaires out there right now that would give you $100,000 in a heartbeat if they can get peace in their soul and have their sins forgiven. But you can't buy it. It's free. It's free. In the book of Luke chapter 23, we read these words. Luke 23, verse 33. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the malefactors, one on the right hand, the other on the left. And then look at his character in verse number 34. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Let me give you just a little bit of what I've learned in years studying. If you want to know what the Jewish people believe, find Jews that have been saved. Amen. Jews for Jesus. You'll find them on the internet. Say, why is that important? Because they know their culture. They know their Talmud. They know what it teaches, and they know what they were taught. They can open up that to you like you wouldn't believe. Just a little while ago, I was watching a thing, doing some research into some of this. And I went to a site, Jews for one of them. I'm not necessarily if it's Jews for Jesus, but it was a Jews that had been saved. And you know what they did? They've got a video posted on that site of a girl mocking the crucifixion of Christ. They've got a monkey, and that monkey is conversing with her of this and that and this and that and this and that, and you can tell that it is viciously antichrist. And then to finish it off, she takes the monkey and she nails him to a cross. I thought to myself, you know, you got a problem. Even if you don't agree with their faith, you got a problem when you're mocking a death like that. You got a problem. What they're doing is they're opening a door and making themselves vulnerable for somebody to think. Why would you do that? Why do they hate him so much? Why do they despise the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you realize, folks, not all Jews now. Somebody said, well, what do the Jews believe? Which ones? Judaism's a big tent. Oh, yes, it's a big tent. But I'll tell you right now, this group, they had a hatred for Christ like you wouldn't believe. That's satanic. Anybody that hates the Lord Jesus Christ, who came and gave himself and nailed him to a cross, and mock that. I'll tell you, I've seen a lot of stuff in my few years on this earth, and when I got through watching that thing, I was upset. It shook me. It bothered me to watch this girl, and she was half naked, to watch her get up there and mock our Lord Jesus Christ and then nail that monkey to a cross. My. I want you to turn to the book of John chapter 14. So do men reject the Lord Jesus Christ because he was nailed on a tree? Maybe they reject him for this. John chapter number 14 and verse number 6. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. That's an absolute statement. That's a powerful statement. I mean, that's a statement. That means I don't care what your religion is, where you live, where you came from, what you know. No man goes to the Father but by me. That's what the book says. Now, I can understand why when people read this, they would hate Christ because it goes against their religion. If you've got a religion that denigrates the Lord Jesus, I can understand when you read that how you could hate him for it. Because the statement he makes is absolute. He said, I am the way and the truth. But you know what? You're getting mighty close right now. You're getting very close to the greatest reason that men hate Christ. Self-righteousness is born in the soul. It eats to the very nature of man. I'm as good as the next fellow. That's what they argue. And the truth of the matter is, they are. The Bible said comparing themselves with themselves are not wise. Sure, I'm as good as the next Joe down the road. Sure I am. But neither one of us are going to go to heaven on our righteousness. Whether I'm as good, worse, better, or whatever, it's not making a difference. There's only one righteousness that God will ever accept, and that's the righteousness of His Son. That's His Son. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. That's one of the first verses I memorized when I got saved. I was talking to a young man this morning from Louisville, Kentucky. And I love talking to people that haven't been saved long. Love it. I love talking to people that have been raised in church. They haven't been raised in church. They don't know all the Christian cliches. They don't know any of this stuff. They're just fresh. Just, you know, here he comes. He said, you know what? He said, I picked up the Bible. And he said, I started reading the Bible. And he said, the Bible's something else. He said, but I hadn't read it too long before it started speaking to me. Oh, yes. He said it started speaking to him. Started speaking to him. He didn't know where that came from. He didn't hear that in church. This is his experience. And then he wound up getting saved. And then God called him to preach. And now he's up preaching the Word of God. Something that's fresh. I love that. I love the testimony. You know, the problem is that we have our kids. We want to raise them right. Lord have mercy. You know that. We want to teach them. We want them to know the Lord. We want all these things. But folks, kids aren't stupid. They learn how to act, how to talk, how to walk, how to fool you, and they even brag about it. How many of you ever heard brag about it? Oh, yeah, they know it. They know the ropes. They know all about it. But the thing is, I also love to hear when they say, you know, I finally got saved. And I've heard a lot of them say that. I finally came back to the Lord. And I was born again. So who is he? Who is this Galilean that lived 2,000 years ago? Did he really live? Certainly he did. There's no question about that. Who was this man? Liberal Christianity says he's a good man, but he was misunderstood, misinformed. He didn't know what he was doing. They don't believe in the virgin birth. They don't believe in the miracles of Christ. They don't believe in the resurrection. They don't believe in any of that. Yet they want to call themselves Christians. Why would you do that? Why would you call yourself a follower of a man who is crazy? The apostle, the Jews said, never man spake like this man. They also said, what manner of man is this, that even the elements obey what he says? I'll tell you what manner of man he is. He's not a man like you've ever seen. You've never seen one like him. Liberal Christianity is not Christianity in any shape or form. So what does academia then? What are they teaching in the universities? I've got a set of books in my office called the Encyclopedia Britannica, 1967 volume. I cannot remember how far back when I was old enough to know anything, I wanted an Encyclopedia Britannica. I did. I wanted that as far back as I can remember. And about 40-something years ago here at Temple Baptist Church, a man gave me that set. Sure did. Tiny C. 1967. There they are. Encyclopedia Britannica. That's published Britannica by the British. And it is written by Oxford, Cambridge, London. Consult by some of the greatest teachers in the world. And they produce that encyclopedia. It's supposed to be the gathering together of the knowledge of man. And you know, it's impressive. Folks, I'm talking about this wide now. Impressive. If you set about to read it from cover to cover, it's going to take you a few years. But do you know what? In all that I've got in that and there, that's not the absolute truth. I can't go to that to find out the real truth. All I can get from that is man's perspective. That's academia. And there's nothing really wrong in the sense of academia. When you go to the doctor the next time, appreciate the fact he knows what he's doing. You don't want some guy on the job training to be operating on you, do you? I understand that. So where do I get the truth of who he is? I don't get it from them. Now listen carefully to what I'm about to say to you. Islam. All right? Muhammad died in 632 AD. Islam. The two great branches of it is Shiite and Sunni. Shia and Sunni. Sunni's the larger branch. They're both looking for the return of a Mahdi, some kind of Messiah. They're looking for him to come back. You talk to one of them, they'll say, oh, we believe Jesus. Oh, yes, and Mary. Oh, yes, Jesus was a great prophet. Jesus was a prophet. And Mary, of course, was his mother. And we believe in the prophets. We believe that the last and the greatest of the prophets, though, was Muhammad. They'll tell you that. But they say, we believe Jesus is coming again. We believe he's going to come again. And he's going to come with a Mahdi. And when he comes with a Mahdi, he's going to come to do away with Ad-Dajjal, the Antichrist. And when they say Antichrist, they're saying anti-Messiah. You have to understand words. When people use a word, what do they mean by that word? What is a Messiah? A Mashiach. He's an anointed one. Oh, they believe he's God. No, there's nowhere in the Bible, folks, that says the Messiah has to be God. You understand that? That's just get that little point right there, okay? The Messiah doesn't, when they believed he was the Messiah, they didn't necessarily believe he was God. Because the Jews to this day, right now, are looking for their Messiah. But if you ask them if they believe he's the Son of God or if he's God, no. He's the deliverer. He's the one who's going to come and set us free. But of course, the Lord Jesus Christ said in Matthew chapter 16, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Moses, Elijah, Jeremiah, one of the prophets. But who do you say that I am? Peter said, thou art the Christ, Messiah. Now listen, you're the Messiah, the Son of the living God. You see how he qualified it? He qualified it. You're the Son of God, he said. So why is that important? Because Jesus and the Mahdi together are going to destroy the Antichrist. And Jesus then is going to preach that the cross is wrong and that the doctrine of the preaching of the cross is wrong and that Islam is the true faith. And he's going to tear down the cross and he's going to point men and women on this earth to Islam, and it's going to bring in an age of peace upon the earth. Now let's put it together. The Jews are looking for the Mashiach, the Messiah. Islam is looking for the Messiah and Jesus. And they're all supposed to be coming back at the end times. Where are we at? According to them, we're in the end times. According to most preaching, we're in the end times. I believe we're close. I have no way of knowing anything except what the Bible says. I know this. I know you live in a great apostasy. I know the love of many shall wax cold. I know that. I know Christianity in this country is just about dead, twice dead and plucked up by the roots. Leastwise professing Christianity. Do I believe the Lord's coming back? Oh, I don't question he's coming back. When's he coming back? He said, if I go, I'll come again to receive you into myself. So what are we looking for? Are we not possibly looking for an Islamic Antichrist? Are we possibly looking into Islam for the Antichrist? You ever wondered how that fits in, how that party fits in? Islam has retained their identity better than anybody on this earth. How do you know that? What happened September the 11th, 2001? They talked about it today. What happened up there in New York City? Saudi Arabian Muslims flew commercial jets into the World Trade Towers and killed over 3,000 people. They did it in the name of Allah. Anything else from the government or anybody else is just a bunch of Mickey Mouse hogwash. I'll tell you who to ask about Muslims. Next time you see Thomas Jefferson, ask him. They were raiding our ships in the Mediterranean. And they asked him, why are you doing this? Why are you raiding our ships? Why are you coming out here taking our cargo and taking us ashore and enslaving us and killing us? Their answer was simple. The Quran commands us to do that. That's what they said. The Quran commands us to do that. So what did Mr. Jefferson do when he finally got the word and found out it was a religious war? What did Mr. Jefferson do? Called in the Marines. That's what he did. You ever hear that Marine hymn where it says, from the shores of Tripoli? That's what he's talking about. He called in the Marines. Yeah. What happened? They took care of it. They took care of it. They took care of it. They went in there with a sword and with a gun and they went in there and they wiped them out and they opened up, and so it was. You didn't have politics involved in it then. Mr. Jefferson didn't have to deal with that. He was the president. He dealt with it face on, took care of it. But now, you let the Muslims kill thousands of people, and the president will gather together a bunch of Muslims and a bunch of everything else. They'll sit down at a big long table, and he'll go out of his way to let you understand that the Muslims are peaceful people. How many remember that? Peaceful people. And nothing personal against Mr. Bush, but he doesn't know one end from the other when it comes to what a Muslim is or anything about this. He has no idea. He doesn't. He has no clue. He has no clue whatsoever. If you know anything about Islam, you'll know that they conquered by the sword and that they took North Africa and they even moved across into Spain. And they were the Moors, and had the Catholics not stopped them in 1683 at the Battle of Vienna, they would have come on into Europe. And guess what kind of shape you'd be in today had they done that? What do you mean? It took battle. It took bloodshed. It took war to stop them from literally overrunning the United States, or overrunning Western Europe. And they did stop them, thank God. Nothing personal, but they stopped them. So we have a religion that is based upon a book that commands them to kill the infidel and to take this world for Allah. So we'll see what happens. An antichrist is going to come, and he may very well come through Islam. Amen. I'll say this about it, and then I'll shut up about Islam. They are far, far, far more dedicated to what they believe than 99% of the Christians that I know. Far more, far more, far more. How do you know that? Those Saudi Arabians got on those jets and flew them into the World Trade Towers knowing they were going to die. Knowing they were going to die. But of course, let me give you this. In Islam, the only way that you can be guaranteed that you're going to go to heaven, to be guaranteed, is to die a martyr. And they died as martyrs. Shaheed, they called it. They died as martyrs. So, yes, yes, Islam and their prophet. Hinduism, a Jew in the Crimea, a Jew in the 1800s, his name was Natovich, and I've mentioned him to you before. He said that Christ went into India and studied under Buddhists and Hindus, and they taught him how to perform miracles, conjure up spirits, and so forth and so on. And so everything that he did when he went back into Galilee, he got it from the Hindu and from the Buddhist. People believe that today. They believe that very thing today. They believe that Hinduism, Buddhism, which is brother and sister, they believe that that is the true revelation understanding of God, their definition of who God is. Sad thing is that most Christians would have no idea at all how to respond to that kind of talk, but that's what they believe. Then you have witchcraft, magic. You talk to a witch, that's the craft, they call it. Keep in mind, the craft. You talk to a witch, and witches are all over the internet. If you don't hear what they have to say, they'll be glad to log on to their website. They'll be glad to tell you what they believe. Do they believe Jesus Christ? Oh, yes, absolutely. They don't believe him as the Savior. He was a worker of miracles. He was magic. He was a magician. There is a thing called a philosopher's stone. How many's ever heard of that? the philosopher's stone is some kind of an essence, is some kind of a thing that holds the secret of how to turn any metal into gold. But it goes further than simply gold. It also has with it this added benefit of eternal life, living forever. The philosopher's stone. That therefore became the basis of alchemy. You've heard of alchemy, I'm sure. Alchemy. And so there are those out there right now who are trying to find the secret of eternal life. Let me tell you what the secret of eternal life is. It's person. It's a person. But that's what they believe. And then, of course, Judaism, as I told you a moment ago. Do your own research in this, and it'll help you greatly. Go to Jews that have been saved and read what they have to say. They can read their Hebrew. They know their Talmud. They know the secrets. They know the buzzwords. They know the code words. Listen to what they have to say, and you'll be amazed it comes out from it. So then that leaves one, Bible-believing Christian. What do I believe about this man? I believe he's God Almighty walking in flesh. If you've seen him, you've seen God. What's the Father look like? You don't have a clue, and I don't either. His Father's a spirit, but I know he manifested himself in the Son. And the Lord Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. How do I understand that? It's a mystery, but it's the Godhead. The Bible said, in him dwelleth the Godhead fully. Fully, bodily. Fully dwelt in him. The Lord Jesus Christ is God of very God. Amen. That's who he is. Not a God. We're not one of the little gods of the big God. Got some charismatics out there teaching that garbage tonight, saying you're God. Listen, you cannot become God. That cannot happen. It cannot happen. You cannot become God. God Almighty is the essence of himself, and there's not another like him, and he has existed from everlasting to everlasting. I can't explain it. I can't understand the essence of God because he's a spirit being, but he has always been. But what he will make of you is a son of God by the new birth. I'm glad for that. Amen. I am so glad for that tonight. He was virgin born. Virgin born. He came to this world. A father was not a man. His father was God. When the Lord Jesus Christ was born in Bethlehem of Judea, he was born when God incarnated himself into a man. Satan is going to do the same thing. He's going to incarnate himself into a man. So how does he do that, preacher? Because Satan's a spirit being. He's a spirit. And he'll incarnate himself into a man. And then when he incarnates himself, in other words, to incarnate means to become flesh. Spanish carne is flesh. Chili con carne. Chili with flesh. Okay, so to incarnate oneself is to go into flesh, is to become flesh. And this is what Satan's going to do. The Antichrist for 3.5 years is going to be a man just like you and me. Not one bit of difference. Born exactly like we are. But then the Bible said Satan will enter in him like he did Judas Iscariot. And he incarnates himself in that man. He does it when? He has a deadly blow to the head. According to Revelation 13, he has a deadly blow to the head. From all indications, he dies. You say, how could Satan raise the dead? Remember this, folks. Remember this. He that letteth will let till be taken out of the way. The Holy Spirit's going to be removed from his hindering. And God Almighty is going to allow a lot of things to happen. And when he does allow these things to happen, it'll be for the glory of God. It'll be things happening that have never happened on this earth before. And he will come back to life. And when he does, he comes back as Satan incarnate. And for 3.5 years, the Antichrist will be more than a man. He'll be the devil walking in flesh. That's going to be something when that happens. Because there's an awful lot of candidates right now begging to be the Antichrist. They want to be him. They want to be the Antichrist in every possible way. Can't imagine. But that's where we are. That's where we've gotten to in 2022. We've gotten to the point where people are no longer reverent. The spirit that I, when I was saved into the church, the spirit in the church in those days was reverence. They believed, and they didn't mock, and they didn't have this dead, rejecting type spirit that you get today. It wasn't like that then. People were believers then. How many of you ever watched the Billy Graham Crusade? You ever watch any of the Billy Graham Crusades? And you see these stadiums filled with 50, 60, 70,000 people. I mean, just look at all these people. And then watch the cameras that pans the congregation. And those people are just sitting there looking. They're just looking. They're listening to what the man has to say. Well, that was in 1970, 1960, 1980. That was back a generation ago. Today? No, it's not like that. It's not like that. Everything's changed. We're running out of time. It's about over. It's about finished. I watched a little snippet from a church service yesterday, a worship service, and if they hadn't told me what it was, I'd have thought, Lord have mercy, I'm right in the middle of a dance hall here. I mean, what's going on? And I mean, the hands were flying everywhere, and people were jumping up and down, and the lights were flashing near, all over the place. And then the music was so loud, you could see the windows vibrating, and they were worshiping. They were worshiping. And what they were doing was having a physical experience with an emotional high. That's what they were having. But you see, that's what it takes, apparently, to get a lot of people into the church house now. Not the drawing of the Holy Spirit. That's what it takes. And they fill them up. They fill them up. And it's so sad. It's so sad. Because I believe the Antichrist is going to have a field day when it comes to the church. He's going to have an awful lot of people in the church house that just absolutely accept him and join up with him. And he becomes their God. And they've rejected Christ. And the end is near. God help us tonight, folks. Don't let it happen to you. It's about over. It's about over. There's not much time left. Father, bless your word. In Jesus' name. Bless your word. Amen. Stand with me tonight and let's pray. Sing. Pray for your loved ones. Pray for your children. Pray for your family. There's a spirit out there now that wasn't here 40 years ago. It's an entirely different spirit. It seems like when a preacher gets up, and I've been at this a while, it seems like when you get up in the pulpit now anymore, that you got this battle going on. There's a pushing type spirit. It wants to take hold of your throat, and it just wants to shut you down. That's what we're getting into now. That's what's happening. Pray that the Holy Spirit will give us freedom, and He'll allow your word to allow God's word to be preached. Amen. We need that. Boy, do we need it. What have we got, brother?
401, the All-American Church Hymnal, Only Trust Him.
Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and He will surely give you rest by trusting in His word. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him.
It's called a suppressing spirit. We had service this morning, church here at Temple. There was a good free spirit in the house. Did you notice? Freedom, worship, freedom. But tonight, there's been a suppressing spirit. Yeah. How many of you felt it?
Amen.
I mean, it's been in here. Suppressing. Satan hates the truth. He didn't like what I was going to preach tonight. Let's sing another verse, brother.
For Jesus shed his precious blood, rich blessings to bestow. Plunge now into the crimson flood that washes white as snow.
Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him.
Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you.
Thank you for listening to me. Don't forget Tuesday, Betty Durr is going to have her hip operated on. She's going to have, from my understanding from Van, they're going to put a hip joint.
They are.
They're going to put a hip joint in. And her hip's broken right now. It's fractured, and so they're going to replace it with a hip joint. And no wonder she was hurting so bad. Yeah. I mean, good night. She's been a lot of pain, folks. Yeah. So please remember her in prayer this coming Tuesday. And okay. Yeah, okay. Amen. Ma'am?
I just want to remind everybody that Tuesday at 6:30, we're having a sisters meeting.
All right. Tuesday at 6:30. Okay. All right. Anybody else? Well, God bless you for coming. Yes, sir.
I just want to let you update on Harley.
Yes. Okay.
Consult with a transplant.
Okay. Right. You mentioned, right. You said that the bone marrow transplant, it might be a thing. But here's, you said about MDS that it could be the beginning or lead to leukemia. All right. In her case, it's rare, but they don't know yet what's going to happen. You taking her to Nashville?
Yes.
Okay.
TriStar.
Okay. All right. Remember Harley. Okay. All right. Yeah. She'll be there what?
We'll be there. We'll have to read there.
About 4 months.
Okay. She needs what she needs. You have to do what you have to do. All right. Let's pray. And Brother Keith Tickell, enjoyed your song tonight, brother. That was good. Amen. Would you lead us in prayer?